who's going to speak to us on heart failure and diabetes. I now hand over to Dr. Ponde.
Thank you very much, chairpersons. It is a really honor and privilege to be the part of this meeting for the first time in my life. Actually, heard of this conference a long number of times, but never had an opportunity to be here. Thank you very much. Heart failure and diabetes. What is new? You must be wondering what a cardiologist is doing in a diabetology conference. In fact, I would show a slide which was shown one of our Singapore conferences recently, and that will be probably an eye-opener. So my question to you is, at the end of this talk, can I have a vote of hands? Are you ready for a change? Great. My job is done, sir. So what are the sad truths about heart failure in general? The sad truths is, heart failure can be deadlier than many cancers. If you look at heart failure 5-year mortality, it's close to around 45% as compared to colonic cancer, leukemia, and even non-Hodgkin lymphoma. It's higher than that. But when you utter the word cancer, the entire family's antennae go up, and they are willing to do anything and everything, their capacities, sell houses, sell property, and do to save that life of a person. As against, when you talk of heart failure, क्या हुआ था? कुछ नहीं, थोड़ी सांस फूली थी, आइस में भरती थे, ऑक्सीजन दिया, अभी घर पे आ गई, ठीक है, everything is good. So the gravity of situation of heart failure is not perceived at large by the society. Overall, heart failure is a progressive condition with high mortality. Every hospitalization causes decline in the quality of life and function of that individual and increases the mortality. As sir said just now, we had 4 corner pillars of the treatment of heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, HEPREF, as we call it, ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, MRAs, and ARBs. And these combinedly have shown approximately 25% risk reduction in the mortality of heart failure when you treat, mind you, when you treat at optimal dosages for minimum 36 months. I have seen prescriptions of carvedilol, 3.125 BD, being carried on year after year after year. And ramipril, 1.25 milligram HS, carried on year after year after year. We have forgotten that only uptitration of these drugs to the guideline recommended dosages produces reduction in mortality. Not that the dose you think is appropriate or I think is appropriate, no. Ramipril, 10 milligrams. Enalapril, 20 milligrams. Carvedilol, 25 milligram BID. Mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, minimum 25 milligram once a day. And ARBs, minimum 80 milligrams twice a day of valsartan, 25 BD of losartan, or 8 milligrams BD of candesartan. People are using ARBs which are not approved in the theory of heart failure for heart failure patients, like telmisartan, olmesartan, and whatnot. Time has come. We need to understand what we are doing. Diabetes-associated complications, Dr. Neglu gave a beautiful talk just now. We always knew about macrovascular and microvascular complications. As a student, my focus was always been like this. But we have forgotten heart failure, which is frequent, fatal, and forgotten. What should I know about diabetes and heart failure? You should know that diabetes causes increased risk of heart failure. And each 1% reduction in HbA1c causes 16% reduction in the incident heart failure over years to come. So tight control of diabetes is important. Is that the only thing that is important? No, not really. And I will show you the evidence for the same. In the right-hand side here, in the dedicated heart failure trials, almost 30% patients had diabetes. And on the dedicated CVOT trials of anti-hyperglycemic drugs, almost 20% patients had heart failure. So the cross-section is pretty big. Having said that, the potential mechanisms linking diabetes to heart failure are multiple. On one side, you have endothelial dysfunction and hemostatic disorders producing coronary artery disease. In the middle, you have diabetic microangiopathy, diabetic myocardial dysfunction, and interstitial deposition of glycated aminoglycans producing interstitial uncoupling and diabetic true diabetic cardiomyopathy. And on the right hand side, you have multiple comorbidities like obesity, obstructive sleep apnea, coronary artery disease, and hypertension, producing increased vascular burden in a patient with diabetes. Heart failure in this big cohort of 1.9 million patients by Shah et al. In 2015 showed that the first manifestation is usually heart failure or peripheral vascular disease, as against what we commonly perceive as coronary artery disease or stroke. That was not the first manifestation of diabetic microvascular complication. Which heart failure is common in diabetics? HEPREF or HEPPEF? Earlier data had shown that in men, HEPREF is more common, and in women, HEPPEF is more common. The recent data has shown that more than half the patients have HEPPEF. These patients are more likely to be women, more likely to be older women, and have history of CKD or hypertension. On the other hand, the remaining half is divided into equal quarters of mid-range ejection fraction and HEPREF, low ejection fraction. These patients are more likely to be men, more likely to have chronic ischemic heart disease or old transmural myocardial infarction. A Kerala registry shown that almost 50% of patients admitted with heart failure have diabetes. Now, does diabetic affect prognosis in heart failure? Our chairperson already told you that yes, diabetes does affect prognosis in heart failure. Increased dysglycemia or dysglycemia is a strong independent risk factor for cardiovascular death in HEPREF patients. 50% increase in annual mortality if your HbA1c remains above 7. And also 50% increase in heart failure hospitalizations if your HbA1c remains above 7.5 in a heart failure patients with diabetes. Having said that, both HEPPEF and HEPREF, the mortality increases. The gray bars are non-diabetics, the blue bars are diabetic. You see, the attrition of diabetic is very fast. Maximum survival of a HEPPEF in a diabetic is 8 years, and that of HEPREF is barely 6 years, which is worse than many of the worst cancers that you have known. On the other hand, heart failure increases the risk of diabetes. More the diuretic use, more the risk of diabetes. So there is an interrelation between diabetes and heart failure. Is prognosis of HEPREF different in an Indian patient? Yes, it is. If you see, sadly, Indian HEPREF patients are younger compared to their Western counterpart, where the mean age is 73 years. In India, the mean age of heart failure patients is 53 years. The in-hospital mortality abroad is around 4%, and here it is 30%. And the 7 or 10 months mortality is outside 9%, and in India, close to 25%. So Indian patients, for some strange reason, have higher mortality with heart failure, and more so in diabetic heart failure. And there are 3 reasons which come to my mind. Number one, we are not aware in treating these patients aggressively to the guideline recommended dosages of ACE, ARBs, MRAs, and beta blockers. Number one. Number two, patients also take heart failure very lightly. And number three, and perhaps the most, mindset of physicians and cardiologists at large for treating heart failure has been quite dismal. Where did we go wrong in treating diabetes? We went wrong because we were glucose-centric. We thought that lowering blood sugar by virtually any means will cause reliable reduction in adverse outcomes. But anti-hyperglycemic drugs produce hypoglycemia. Glitazones-like drugs produce fluid retention. Most of the anti-hyperglycemic drugs produce increase in LDL and weight gain. These side effects of the drugs negated the beneficial effects of lowering HbA1c. This is called hypothesis of zero-sum game in treating diabetic patients with oral antidiabetic drugs. Every 3 kg increase in weight reduces or nullifies the effect of beneficial effects of 1% reduction in HbA1c, mind you, in terms of calories. And therefore, intensive control of diabetes in terms of HbA1c has not been associated with benefit in heart failure outcomes. You'll ask me, Dr. Ponday, why is that? You said diabetics have more heart failure. You said that reduction in HbA1c causes 16% reduction in incident heart failure. Then by tight control of diabetes, why does heart failure severity and prognosis not affected? For one simple reason. We have been treating diabetics with heart failure with drugs which produce LDL increase, weight gain, fluid retention, and blood pressure increase in the past. So now this slide shows you, once you reduce blood pressure, reduce LDL, and reduce HbA1c together, you come at this sweet spot, and this sweet spot causes significantly least mortality in heart failure. So heart failure and diabetes is the most common complication. It is a deadly complication. It has very high rate of subclinical heart failure, and effects of glucose-lowering drugs vary. Eugene Braunwald, the father of cardiology, in one of our meetings, sir, he said, surely the time has come for cardiologists to learn more about diabetes and diabetologists to learn more about cardiology. Perhaps it is now appropriate to establish a new subspecialty called diabetocardiology, whose practitioners will become the first frontline troops in this war. And how very true. How very true is that? As cardiologists, what do we expect from an anti-diabetic agent? What do I expect? I want a potent and durable glycemic control. I want a robust evidence base. I want it to be cardio safe. I want it to have pleiotropic benefits. And if at all, weight reduction, if not possible, it should be at least weight neutral. That is what cardiologists want. Do we have drugs that fulfill our expectations? Yes. At the end of a dark tunnel in diabetic heart failure, we had sacubitril valsartan. ARNI came as an absolute blessing for diabetic heart failure. In ARNI paradigm heart failure trial, 25% patients were non-diabetics and 25% were pre-diabetic. It showed 20% risk reduction in cardiovascular death and heart failure death over and above that afforded by or allocated by maximally tolerated doses of ACE, beta blockers, and MRA. Mind you, paradigm trial was run in patients who were optimally treated with all the possible best drugs available. And on the top of that, ARNI showed 20% risk reduction. It showed risk reduction, not only it showed reduction in HbA1c, it also showed 29% reduction in new use of insulin in patients with HEPREF. Then came a big step forward. The big step forward, as you all know, was SGLT2 inhibitors. These drugs produce glycosuria. These drugs were insulin independent in their action. They don't depend on insulin in their action. They produce caloric loss in urine, cause weight loss, called single-digit BP decrement, LDL decrement, HDL increase, and microvascular function improvement, including endothelial function improvement. A thrifty hypothesis says that mild persistent ketonemia causes energy-efficient superfuel, which drives the myocardium to handle the load better and better. This is one more additional reason why SGLT2 did better, that they cause weight loss, which is so very important in overweight patients with heart failure. Also, compared to diuretics, which cause volume contraction, SGLT2 inhibitors, when they cause diuresis, they cause loss of volume from interstitial compartment, not from intravascular compartment. Thereby, they don't produce secondary activation of RAS system. What a beneficial, beautiful effect of these drugs. So the cohort studies like EMPEREC, CANVAS program, and DECLARE all showed significant risk reduction in terms of mortality, cardiovascular deaths, 3-point MACE, and recurrent hospitalizations in heart failure. In fact, empagliflozin consistently reduced cardiovascular death in type 2 diabetes with or without heart failure burden. If you look at all the antidiabetic drugs, only SGLT2-1 inhibitors and GLP-1 receptor agonists have shown consistent benefits in heart failure death and heart failure recurrent hospitalization reduction. This is extremely important to understand. So if your patient is on such as a drug like sulfonylureas or glitazones, please take them off and institute a SGLT2 inhibitor if your patient has HEPEF or HEPREF. Please do not pass on patient's breathlessness as, oh, you are stressed, oh, you are overworked. No, get an NT-proBNP done and surprise will hit you. NT-proBNP will be in thousands, telling you, my patient is actually a HEPEF. Get an echocardiogram done, for heaven's sake, from a good echocardiographer. And then came DAPA-HF. This trial was the pivotal trial in management of diabetic and non-diabetic patients with heart failure. Time and again, after the three trials, we cardiologists were thinking whether SGLT2 inhibitors are anti-diabetic drugs or are they anti-heart failure drugs. DAPA-HF trial enrolled diabetic and non-diabetic patients, optimally treated patients with near normal GFR to 10 milligram of dapagliflozin versus placebo. And what happened? These patients were 90% treated with ACE, beta blocker, MRAs, etc. 20% reduction in heart failure mortality. P-value of 0.00001. Number needed to treat 21 patients for 1 year to prevent one death. As against, if you look at, you need to treat 26 patients with ACE inhibitors and 32 patients with ARNI to prevent one death. You need to treat only 21 patients with dapagliflozin to prevent one death in heart failure. They also showed reduction in worsening heart failure events. No diabetes or diabetes, effect was different. No ARNI or ARNI, the effect was the same. So whether that patient was treated with ACE or no ACE, ARNI or no ARNI, patient diabetic or non-diabetic, DAPA significantly produced heart failure benefit. All-cause death, which is the hardest endpoint in any clinical trial, was also substantially benefited with dapagliflozin. This drug has caused paradigm shift in the management of heart failure patients with diabetes. And now, we as cardiologists have started treating even non-diabetic patients with heart failure with dapagliflozin. I have treated until now 21 patients, 19 have finished more than 4 months, all of them are doing well. One I had to withdraw because of genital mycotic infection out of 21 patients. All-cause death has been prevented by only two SGLT2 inhibitors, empagliflozin and dapagliflozin. Canagliflozin has not been able to show benefit in all-cause mortality. So whether heart failure comes first or diabetics comes first, SGLT2 inhibitors will prevail and will treat. Have the guidelines changed? Yes, of course. You know that they have changed. I don't need to show you these slides. But there are potential several pleiotropic benefits of SGLT2. Decrease glucose, decrease weight gain, decrease albuminuria, decrease sympathetic activity, natriuresis, ketonemia, oxidative stress reduction, uric acid reduction, increase HDL, and decrease arterial stiffness. They almost look like a magical pill. And time will come, a trial of HEPEF is in way to show whether DAPA will help HEPEF patients as well. So SGLT2 inhibitors is now class 1A indication for treating HEPREF patients with diabetes for heart failure. So my goal in this lecture, my friends, was not to give you some ideas about what is happening, but to create a therapy of ideas, to try to bring in new ideas so that we can see the same old problems little differently. Remove the cobwebs from our brain of prejudices, whims and fancies. Depend on evidence-based medicine and treat your patients well. Happy Holi to all of you. Thank you. I don't think there's any time for questions, right?
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for throwing the light on this SGLT2 inhibitors.
Thank you.
I have two questions.
Yeah.
On the cardiologist point of view, this drug is helpful in a patient who has a diabetic with HFrEF and who has a normal ejection fraction heart failure. So is it useful in the non-diabetic also, and where you will place? Is it a first line of treatment? Because this SGLT2 inhibitor, they are a pleiotropic, like a diuretics and everything and all the effects they have. So what is your opinion about this?
I don't think this can be the first line drugs really. We still will depend upon beta blockers because they are the ones which reduce sudden cardiac death in HFrEF patients. Two will be possibly ARNI. Now ACE inhibitors have taken a back seat after ARNI, and when optimally treated patients with these two still are symptomatic, then probably DAPA could be added. This is what where we stand as of today. Probably further trials which are in the pipeline, sir, might take these drugs ahead of ARNI. I don't know. That may or may not happen. About heart failure with preserved EF, I have my own doubts. Because HEPPEF, even ARNI has failed to show benefits. Meaning thereby, HEPPEF is a different animal. It is not only myocardium. HEPPEF is a patient with generalized endothelial dysfunction, obesity, multiple comorbidities like OSA, COPD, CKD, and so on. So there is a lot of things going wrong in the entire body of a patient with HEPPEF. I don't think a single molecule will ever be able to win war against HEPPEF. It will be a multimodality management.
Thank you, sir. Any questions from the audience?
Just sharing experience from my city of Ahmedabad. Some of my cardiologist colleagues are like you, using SGLT2 inhibitors in non-diabetic population with reduced heart ejection fraction class.
So I think at the same time,
all boldly doing that.
Yeah. Just to play devil's advocate, I must say here that one cannot forget genital mycotic infections, particularly in Indian community where personal hygiene is a question. Number two, urinary tract infections. And number three, euglycemic ketosis. So critically ill patients, sick patients, septic patients, patients who are frail and elderly are not the group of patients in whom I would even touch SGLT2 inhibitors, even as a third line. A patient who is not monitored, whose medications are taken by the patient himself or herself, nobody in the family to monitor the patient's medicines, is a big, big problem to give SGLT2. So I think a caution is exercised. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think the learned crowd in this hall, all of them are conversant.
I think Chandragan, Dr. Chandragan is my good friend and he's my classmate also. You might be coming across with the patients like obesity, hyperventilation syndrome with coronary and heart failure. Can you use this molecule in such cases?
No, that's what I'm saying. For HEPPEF, heart failure with preserved EF, there is no data, and Paragon AF trial on with ARNI on HEPPEF has miserably failed to show substantial benefit in mortality. Meaning thereby, we need to look at HEPPEF in a very different way. We need to look at HEPPEF not only as a myocardial disease, it's a disease affecting the entire body's multiple organ systems. And therefore, I don't think DAPA will succeed in HEPPEF. I don't think so.
In cases of refractory heart failure, can you
use
refractory last molecule?
Yes, refractory heart failure is the last molecule. Yes, you can possibly think of this. Thank you.
Yeah, you know, in patients with DAPA HF, yes, there were more patients who were non-diabetic.
Absolutely, yes.
There are 55% patients who were non-diabetic.
Yes.
And even in those,
Yes.
There was a substantial benefit which was seen with DAPA as compared to diabetes.
Exactly. So SGLT2 inhibitors are our drugs, sir, not your drugs. Yeah. Thank you.